It is a very difficult area in terms of any form of restraint, and I don't think anybody who you speak to wants to be involved in it really. There has been considerable investment made in our sector by the adjustable real-time CCTV, which is fantastically important and a really good opportunity for people to investigate, and also clearly as a training opportunity to talk to staff and look through incidents and manage that. And that's been in place for a number of years now, and I think that's particularly helpful. As I think is a real push, certainly in our establishments, to use restorative justice, not only in its wider context with conferencing and so on, but following incidents with young people, so that that framework, as I added in the appendices to the information I sent, it allows young people to be debriefed, and everybody, not just young people, but the staff as well, to learn from any incident, to minimise it. I think there's a number of things that need to be put into context in relation to restraint. And that is that the majority of young people who we look after, despite their histories and behaviours in the communities, do extremely well and behave extremely well. And the tendency is sometimes to demonise all young people in custody as being, you know, extremely difficult and challenging to manage. And yes, they have a lot of challenging issues, but quite often they work very well with the staff. So often we're talking of a very small group of highly challenging young people where restraint sometimes is used. Also, in the majority of cases, incidents tend to be spontaneous, particularly with adolescent boys on a football field, put a tackle in suddenly, because that's the behaviour they exhibit in the community. They're squaring up with each other, and their first recourse is to be violent to each other, and that requires an intervention, otherwise somebody would be hurt. And the majority of incidents are extremely spontaneous. And often, because the groups of young people live together and can work through those issues with each other, and rewards incentive schemes look at encouraging positive behaviour, they will learn to work together with each other, which I think is critically important, rather than revert to inappropriate sort of aggressive behaviour. Staff training, as you alluded in your first report, is critical. It's not just staff training, but ongoing training. And training in de-escalation and skills in de-escalating critical incidents is very important. We brought in some time ago a minimisation strategy, which is now right across the school state. We have improved over time as a sector the information we receive on young people. So that's helped you to manage young people's behaviour at the point of view, particularly if they're well known in the secure state. And so that can help you build an individual behaviour plan for the young person that helps them cope rather than having no information on them at all. So all those things are in place and are working more effectively over time. So it's not, I think as I'm trying to evidence to you, I think there has been significant progress to make. But it is, you know, we've been talking about, ever since I've been in this work, we've been talking about this subject, of how we manage some of the most challenging children in any kind of setting, whether it's a dual zone, a secure dual zone. It's not an easy thing to do. It's not an easy thing to do to start to get the judgment right. Any time they do it, it's a risk, and you know, it's more important wherever possible, as I think the last speaker alluded to have a culture in the establishment that enables people to recognise when that's happened and report it as soon as possible. So we get a positive culture in an establishment.
Thank you. I think there are four things I want to ask you about. I'll start with your reference to mental health issues. What methodology do you have in your SDCs to ensure that staff are aware which of your charges have mental health issues, which may contraindicate not only the use of restraint, but also the use of the touch-hold policy?
Right. In terms of the young people coming into the centre, then obviously we will have, one would hope, a reasonable amount of information related to that young person. The young person comes in, they are seen on admission by a qualified social worker or a psychologist. And there are a range of standardised tools used across the secure estate to analyse a young person's mental health, which the adjustable report brought in, which staff are trained to use. And there's two categories. So young people are screened at that early stage. And that information will be fed into a behavioural management plan. And probably at a very early stage, the individual counselling and support for that young person. And as you'll see from our evidence, in our settings, we have an arrangement with St Andrew's Hospital, one of the leading hospitals, who provide clinical guidance and supervision to all our staff who undertake those assessments, then undertake the direct work with young people. Now, quite clearly, there are some situations where our setting is inappropriate for those young people, and we will flag that up with the youth justice placements team and with the necessary agencies in the community to see whether we are providing the right setting for young people. I have to say my experience is that quite rightly it's very difficult, and I think probably it should be, to have something exceptional in mental health. But some young people with perhaps emerging personality problems are very difficult to, they fall in effect between a hole in the middle. They're not serious enough to have perhaps going to a psychiatrist hospital, but their behaviour is very difficult to manage within a secure setting, the confines of what a secure setting is there to do. So, you know, that is how we manage.
Can I be a little bit more specific? Because you mentioned St Andrew's Hospital, and I was actually thinking of St Andrew's Hospital, which I visited on a number of occasions. Mm. In the child and adolescent mental health setting of St Andrew's Hospital, and indeed in every county ward that I've ever visited, there is a lead clinician for every patient. Now, I know you're not dealing with patients, but it seems to me to be arguable that there should be somebody equivalent of a lead clinician dealing with every resident, every client, if they are suffering from mental health issues. Do you do that? And if not, why not?
Right, we have in our healthcare team, there will be each young person will allocate a member of our healthcare team, and if the young person has mental health issues, they'll go to the mental health lead on that, or they'll go to the person in our youth offending team with the mental health lead. We link in then to the St Andrew's psychiatry team, so they will see any young person within 3 days of referral, which is far quicker than anybody might see in the community. And then we'll be guided by the clinical governance and their support to do that. So that's how we manage that process, you know, which I think is speedy. I mean, the real difference is, as you'll know from St Andrews, is, you know, our average length of stay is around 11 weeks, and their average length of stay is 2.5 years. And I took Martin Mary and Graham Rock round to look at that. I visit, many of the young people there have been in wildlife and other. And you wondered how they had their coat drift, and they're there for 2.5+ years on a intensive treatment program, and yet we find them in the secure state, and unless we can get some intervention and help to move them appropriately, we've got them for 11 or 12 years. You know, I think we have to have the context of what we have a no refusal policy in all the secure state, really, so we have to look after those young people who aren't on sentence from the court to try and manage and get an individual care plan for those young people. Mental health issues are a real challenge to get everybody working together and get a proper pathway for that child into the proper resource. I mean, you know, it drives you bonkers to be quite honest.
If I may change the subject, the touch and hold policy, which